second award.
Yes, thank you very much for the introduction and the award. Obviously, this work I'm presenting is not just my own. I've worked with a lot of great people, not least the BI project. So when it comes to gut microbiota, or microbiota in general, small is big. 99% of the unique genes in our body are bacterial, and just 1% are human. The gut microbiota, which is a complex community of microorganisms within our digestive system, the weight can reach up to 2 kilos, and in 1 millimeter of colonic content, it contains more bacteria than there are people on the earth. So the headline figures are really quite impressive when it comes to microbiota. But I think what I find most evocative is this idea that they've co-evolved with us. They've been with us from the start, and they're very intrinsic to our functioning. And without them, we maybe would not be able to achieve our full potential as humans. So we've evolved with them to such an extent that there are some components of the breast milk, the human human milk oligosaccharides, which amount to 10% of the content of breast milk. These are not digestible by infants themselves. They're only digestible by a particular gut bacteria. So we're providing food for our gut bacteria, not even just for our babies. So just to give you a quick idea, here's the infant gut, gut of the fetus. During pregnancy, it's completely protected, it's sterile, it's in the amniotic sac, and then through birth and delivery and after 3 years, the diversity of the infant gut develops, and in 3 years it's as diverse as the adult gut. The big event, birth, is the one which gives us our first loading of gut bacteria, and that leads the way for how our gut are going to progress and grow, what kind of communities are going to form. So with the vaginal delivery, the normal kind of delivery, the first loading of the bacteria in the infant is with from the vagina, from the feces, from all the messy stuff that happens with birth. But with cesarean section babies, what happens is the first bacteria that they experience is from the skin or from the hospital air, and then these babies go off to develop a different kind of gut. Other important factors come from internal environmental factors, not least breastfeeding and introduction of formula or solid food. Breastfed babies have very low gut diversity, and then as these sort of other external environmental factors are coming into the gut, it leads to more diversity. So the weaning process is very important in the increasing of diversity. So one of the main roles of the gut bacteria is as signalling metabolites. They communicate between the outside world and us, the hosts. The majority of the chemicals in our blood actually are made by the gut microbiota, so that gives you an idea of just how important they are. And here they are at the mucosal barrier communicating with the host. One of the important bacteria metabolites are the short-chain fatty acids. So they've been implicated in a number of different health and disease outcomes, which I'll refer to a bit later. But they're also interesting because they're exposed directly to breast milk contaminants. So contaminants we're interested in here are persistent organic pollutants. We looked at dioxin-like, non-dioxin-like PCBs, which is generated through industrial processes. We've got the organic chlorine pesticides, like DDT, which you've probably all heard of. Brominated flame retardants, which do what it says on the tin, and the non-stick perfluorinated compounds, PFOS and PFO, which are used in Gore-Tex, Teflon, and non-stick food products. So these are important because despite being banned, well, the majority have been banned for decades, they bioaccumulate, because of their properties, they bioaccumulate within the individual, so as we age, and then biomagnify up the food chain. So humans, we sit at the top of the food chain, are very exposed. We're exposed a lot through diet, particularly fish, meat, and dairy, and also through, in the case of brominated flame retardants, through dust, household dust. Now, infants are exposed in utero through, they receive the mother's body burden of chemicals, then also through breastfeeding postpartum. We know that many toxicants, persistent toxicants, have been associated with a number of health outcomes related to allergic disease, obesity, neurodevelopment, and coincidentally, so do some of the health outcomes associated with gut bacteria that metabolize acidity. So we're interested to know, could one of the mechanisms by which toxicants affect the infant health, or child health, could one of the mechanisms be through the gut microbiota? So this is a study that we looked at in the region human genomic cohort. It's 2,600 children in Norway. This part of the study looks at the children. There's 267 mother-child pairs, but 1 month postpartum had environmental chemicals that had been measured in breast milk, and then also gut microbiota composition that had been assessed from extraction from the DNA extraction from fecal samples. We also have short-chain fatty acids that were measured in the fecal samples in the subset. We excluded children who had been exposed to antibiotics 2 to 4 weeks before, as antibiotics obviously are antibacteria and they will wipe out the population, but also we know that after one course of antibiotics, despite the dysbiosis, the communities very quickly recover. And then we also excluded twins from this study. In terms of the methods, we looked at 28 different chemicals. We looked at the outcomes alpha diversity, so that's the number and the type of bacteria that are within an individual, that's your alpha diversity. And then you've got beta diversity, which is looking between two groups. So you've got the diversity between two groups. We looked at that in terms of the composition of the microbiome, but we also looked at the predictive function of metagenome. So we looked at all of the genes, and we matched them to different kinds of functions, and we can predict what these little bacteria are able to do. And then we also looked at taxonomic differences, and then the short-chain fatty acids. We used traditional EPI methods for these, looking at alpha diversity and short-chain fatty acids. So we used multivariate linear regression, and because we're looking at a lot of different compounds, we used the elastic net penalized regression method to select between these correlated variables. We're able to do that for these two, and then in the others, the other analyses, we just looked at low, medium, and high groups of exposed children, just looking at breastfeeding. So our main, we did a lot of stuff and we found some very interesting results. This is probably one of the most interesting that we can focus on, and then I'll just explain. So basically, the contaminants seem to really strongly influence these short-chain fatty acids, the metabolites of the gut bacteria. So they influence the functioning of the bacteria. Here you've got all of the toxicants, 28 toxicants, grouped by class of toxicants, and then this is a percentage increase relative to the mean of these two compounds, acetic acid and propionic acid. This shows also the single polluted model, which is just the orange, and then the elastic net selected are the green, and then modeled together in this multi-polluted model. And these multi-polluted models explain 30% of the variance in acetic acid and propionic acid. And this is a much stronger model for explaining what's going on compared to the models for alpha diversity, where we only explain 4% of the variance of those models. So overall, there was a 20 to 25% decrease in the short-chain fatty acids. You can see that on these sides of the zero. But two that stuck out were the dioxin-like, PCB 167 here and PFOA, okay, compound, where there's actually up to a 50% increase in these short-chain fatty acids. So, of all these analyses we did, we kind of found that there were patterns across the different classes of compounds that came out. The first that I draw your attention to is here, the dioxin. much more diverse. This is very interesting for us because what happens is that we see that when we look at the animal studies, we also see the same thing as increase in short-chain fatty acids in the mice studies, particularly in those that are aryl hydrocarbon, the ones that have the aryl hydrocarbon receptor, and we also see an increase in diversity in the frogs. So we find some compelling support from experimental studies for these results. Non-dioxin-like PCBs, in contrast, we found decreases in the diversity, and this was also found in animal studies. Pesticides also tended towards the decrease. Here, this, I'm not going into these, this is more the composition of individual bacteria that we found differences in. The BDEs were also decreased here, and then for P4, it seemed again more like an increase, but for none of these other compounds have we found any experimental research. And then for PFOS, we find a decrease in diversity, which is also in a mice study. So it's all very new, there's not very much out there, but the signals that we do get seem to match some of the signals that are coming from the animal studies, so we're quite excited about that. So what do we know? We think that the breast milk contaminants do perturb the gut microbiome more in function than the composition, but that time will tell. And that we want to know what are the implications for human health, especially in countries with higher environmental contaminant exposure than in Norway. Thank you.
Increased diversity is a good thing.
Yeah, I mean, this, our hypothesis is obviously, yeah, we expect it to be a decrease, and I